I would say, you know, the road that I've been on has been completely unexpected. Like, when I look at every aspect of my life, even where I'm at today, it's unexpected. You know, it's like, how did this happen? But it's not, wasn't my plan, you know.
Remi Adeleke was born in Nigeria into a very wealthy family. His father was a well-known businessman and engineer, and his mother was an American from New York City who met him on one of his many business trips.
My family had everything. We had cars and nannies and drivers, and my dad, he engineered one of the first man-made islands in the world. So yeah, I am this kid whose dad created an island. So yeah, that was what my life was like. My mom, she didn't want for anything. We traveled the world, and it was a good life early on.
Remy's family wasn't just wealthy. His father was also a chief in the Yoruba tribe, which made him Nigerian royalty.
So not only was I born into literal wealth and prestige, but we also had the figurative title of royalty and riches and all that sort of thing. I haven't really followed the tradition so much so, but technically, you know, I'm a prince.
The family's wealth and status also made them a target for those jealous of what they had. The Nigerian government at the time was notoriously corrupt and decided to strip Remy's father of all his assets, his home, his wealth, even his family's private island. His father attempted to fight the government in court, but died weeks later.
So we went from rich to poor in that moment. And my mother was just like, there's no way I'm raising my kids here in Nigeria. And so that's when she permanently relocated my brother and I to the United States, specifically to Bronx, New York. You know, I tell people all the time, you know, my mom, you know, she did a great job of masking the reality of what had happened. Best analogy I could use is, it was as though my mother created this movie set, and on the movie set everything seemed okay, right? But when you walk off the set, you know, it was chaos, you know? There were times when my mother would give my brother and I a bar of Ivory soap and say, you know what, I don't have money to do laundry. You know, you guys wash your underwears and socks in the sink. You know, there were times when my mom didn't have enough food to feed herself. She had just enough food to split between my brother and I. She would go hungry throughout the night. And I remember going with my mom to her rent office and watching her plead for extra time to pay the rent because she couldn't afford it. So it was a struggle. It was really, really hard.
Even at 8 years old, Remy said he'd never thought he'd escape poverty. Feeling trapped in his new life, he turned to crime. At first, as a way to steal things he wished he could afford, but soon branching into serious crime, settling into selling pagers and throwaway phones to drug dealers. Then one day, everything came crashing down.
Yeah, I sold a drug dealer bunch of phones and pagers that were supposed to last for a certain amount of time, and only last for a fraction of that time, and that was because, you know, the people I was kind of working through, the company I was working through, caught on to my scam. And they started cutting the activation time. So the bill would cut off. So I sold this drug dealer, like it had to be about 30 phones. And he came to my house and threatened my life. And, you know, that was a huge wake up call for me. Cause at that point, my mom was in the apartment, she was asleep. And, you know, that's when I just looked at myself after he threatened my life, because I knew his personality. I knew he would kill me if I didn't give him his money. And I said, you know, I'm going to give him his money back. And I got him his money back in a day. And then I decided I'm getting out of this game because it's not worth my life or my mother's life. So that's when I decided I'm done with all illegal stuff. No more drug dealing, no more cell phone stuff. I don't know what I'm going to do with my life, but I'm not going to do this anymore.
When he was younger, Remy's favorite movies were The Rock and Bad Boys, two Michael Bay movies featuring action, adventure, and Navy SEALs. Now looking for a fresh start in life, he decided he would join the Navy and become a SEAL himself.
I wanted to be challenged. You know, my life had been hard, and I wanted to make it harder.
However, due to his criminal history, joining the Navy would be a bigger challenge than he thought.
I had 2 warrants out for my arrest, which I didn't know I had. There was a Navy recruiter named Tiana Reyes. When I went to her office, she ran my background, found that I had 2 warrants. I had a warrant in New Jersey, I had a warrant in New York. And I got up and got ready to run out of the recruiting office. And she said, where are you going? I'm getting out of here. I'm not trying to go to jail today. And she said, come back tomorrow in a suit. I said, I don't have a suit. She said, come back in a collar shirt and some nice pants. And I did. And she took me to both judges, and the judge of Jersey, the judge of New York. And she was in her dress uniform and she advocated on my behalf. You know, she said 9/11 just took place. This guy's trying to join the Navy after an act of war. Can we expunge his record so that he could join the military? And both judges unanimously expunged my record. That's how I got in the Navy. And, you know, her decision to do what she did for me really motivated me to stay out of trouble in the Navy and work hard and achieve my dream of becoming a SEAL.
Remy's challenges weren't over yet. Despite being eligible to join the Navy, he couldn't swim and scored too low on the physical and mental aptitude tests to qualify for SEAL training. Remy enlisted as a corpsman and was assigned to the Naval Hospital at Camp Pendleton as his first duty station. Immediately after checking into his command, he began training for basic underwater demolition SEAL training, known as BUDS. After only a year at his command, he qualified for SEAL training and checked in for BUDS. He made it through the notoriously difficult phase of training known as Hell Week, but was held back in training due to being a weak swimmer.
Now, from a mental toughness standpoint, I was all there. You know, the issue with me at that point was more pride. It was more, I made it through Africa, I made it through the Bronx. It's not many African Americans in SEAL training as it is. So instead of working on what I needed to work on a weekend, because the instructors would show up on a weekend for guys who made it through Hell Week, the instructors would show up and help work with guys on stuff they were struggling with, whether it was, you know, diving related stuff or swims or whatever. And I was out partying on the weekend because in my mind, I already made it. Like, I'm gonna make it. And it was all my pride. My pride is where I failed. And so when I got to second phase and the swim times for the 2 mile time ocean swim dropped from 85 minutes to 80 minutes, I failed my first two swims. I didn't make the time. And then I got to dive phase and I failed the test 4 times in dive phase. And at that point, the instructors were just like, dude, you know, you're a hard dude. We see that. You've made it through Hell Week. You know, you made it through first phase, you've gotten this far, but you need to work on your swims. And this is not the place for you to work on it anymore. And they kicked me out of BUDS.
Having been kicked out of BUDS, Remy returned to life as a corpsman, this time assigned to a Marine infantry unit. Instead of feeling defeated, however, he saw his failure as a lesson and was determined to return to training.
Because I had the mental toughness piece already nailed down, I needed to get humility, and I also needed to grow as a man. You know, I also needed to learn from my failures, and then also learn that a failure is only a failure if you don't learn from it, but if you learn from it, it's a lesson. I needed to get that lesson, you know, out of getting kicked out of SEAL training. And I'm so grateful for it because I apply that lesson today. As a husband, as a father, as a businessman, you know, I run a couple different businesses and I'm applying lessons from getting kicked out of SEAL training the first time to now, you know, so yeah.
After a year and a half with the Marines, Remy returned to BUDS, starting all over again from day one. This time, with the lessons he learned, he graduated and earned his SEAL Trident.
There were two feelings. There was one of, I was grateful. Like at that point, it was just like, I was humble and I was grateful. Cause I was just like, man, it wasn't like, yeah, I made it, look at me. You know, me getting kicked out of BUDS the first time, you know, dealt with that part of it, right? At this point, it was like, I'm grateful. I'm grateful to be here. That was one feeling that I had. The next feeling I had was, I'm ready to get to work. Like, making it through BUDS is nothing, right? You know, every SEAL has made it through BUDS. Like, it's actually getting to a platoon and doing the work, you know? And so for me, you know, I was just eager. I was just like a caged pit bull, you know, who had been in a cage for like 10 years and not fed, and I'm ready to get out and eat something, right? Like, I was just ready to get to work and do the job of a SEAL and not just walk around with a trident on my chest. So that was the feeling that I had.
Remy acted as his platoon's medic, utilizing his background as a corpsman, as well as doing intelligence gathering.
I had a great time in SEAL teams, you know, and I got, and then, but the best part about it for me was the guys, you know, working with the best guys on the planet, legends, and, you know, just rolling with them out the door and just being a part of a unit that personifies excellence, you know, and everybody's challenging everybody to be the best and to do the best. You know, I don't think I'll ever have that experience anywhere outside of the SEAL teams, you know, so yeah.
During his time in the teams, having completed 3 deployments, Remi discovered being a SEAL also helped him confront past childhood trauma he experienced as a victim of bullying growing up in the Bronx.
I saw a lot of bullying. You know, I was bullied. You know, I was jumped. I was beat up. And, you know, and I saw people get picked on. I saw there were times where I would see one person get beat up by 6 people, you know, walking back from school. And I always despised that. And that's why, you know, I never got involved in the gangs. Because all gang members were cowards. You know what I mean? Like, it needs to be 7 of you to beat on one person. That's not a manly, that's not hard, you're a coward. And so I hated bullies. And so another reason why I wanted to be a SEAL is because I wanted to go after bullies. I wanted to go after those people who picked on the weak, who picked on those who can't protect themselves. I wanted to be the one who could knock on their door and just be like, hey, you're talking all that junk on the camera, you're picking on all of these people, you're killing these people, do it to me. Like, here I am, what you got to say now? And so I love that aspect of the job. And it fulfilled me because, you know, here I was, you know, having come from this environment where I saw a lot of people picked on and jumped, and now being able to take that and be the person standing in the gap, that meant a lot to me.
In 2016, now married and a father of 2 young boys, Remi decided it was time to leave the Navy and the demanding life of being a SEAL behind to focus on being a father, something he missed due to his own father passing away when he was young. He enrolled in college using his GI Bill, but didn't know what he wanted to do with his life after school. Then he got a phone call that changed everything.
I was in my office, and I wasn't in this house at that point. I was in a different house, and I was writing papers for grad school, and my phone rings, and this lady's on the other end of the line, and she says, hey, Michael Bays, looking for a former SEAL, help out on this movie. Are you available tomorrow? And I was just like, sure, Michael Bay, yeah, I'll do it. And then she told me to send her some pictures. I didn't have headshots, I just had regular pictures, so I sent them to her, and she was like, hey, you're on. And then next day I'm on set with Michael Bay and Josh Duhamel, and I'm shooting a scene for Transformers last night. And it was just supposed to be that one day, and then I got a phone call about a week and a half later from that same lady, and she said, hey, Bay, you know, likes it, you could take direction and your look on set and all that. Are you available to come back for 3 more weeks? And I said, sure. So I did a week in Arizona, 2 weeks in Michigan. And then at the end of the second week, a PA approached me and said, Bay wants to know if you'd like to stay on until the film wraps. And I said, sure. And so I ended up staying on the film until it wrapped, and did some consulting on it and acting on it. And that's where I would say my career started, you know, in the film and TV industry. And it definitely wasn't what I was trying to do. I didn't know what I was going to do. And I ended up still finishing my master's degree during that process, but that's where I found, I guess, my next calling.
Since acting in Transformers, Remi has starred in many commercials, worked on TV shows as an actor and advisor, and acted in another upcoming Michael Bay movie. He also found he had a gift for writing, and after completing his autobiography, he decided to try his hand at writing something different.
After that, I was just like, man, I love writing. I just love storytelling, and not just from the acting side, but being able to be at the inception of the story, and that's writing. And so I was just like, you know what? I can write another book, or I can write a film. So I wrote a film. So I wrote my first film, which was a spy thriller, and that got a lot of buzz. And then I wrote another film, a historical black film, which we're shopping right now. Should hopefully get picked up in the next month or so. And that just started building. So now I write films, I consult on films and TV shows and commercials, and I do act. But I would label myself more of a writer than anything at this point.
Remy credits much of his success in the entertainment industry to the hard lessons he learned from his time in the Navy.
Yeah, serving was huge for me. I mean, it changed my life. And being a part of the Navy, you know, and the SEAL teams as well, you know, is a huge part of my life. And it's something that no one could ever take away from me. You know, having been able to wear the uniform and go overseas and you know, and protect those who couldn't protect themselves, you know, that will always be with me. And though I can't do the job anymore physically because I'm older now and I have so many injuries, but I'm grateful. I'm grateful for the opportunity I had that the Navy gave me. You know, I grew up as a man in the Navy when you really think about it, because I joined when I was, you know, turning 20 years old. And so the majority of my adult life has been the Navy and the military. So the Navy pretty much raised me.
Despite his successes, Remy said he hasn't forgotten where he came from and the struggles he faced, and does what he can to give back and try to help other at-risk kids from poor communities like the Bronx.
Yeah, you know, I try to at least, at a minimum, once a month, do some type of outreach to inner city youth. Even if it's just once a month, even if it's just spending an hour with a kid who doesn't have a dad, you know, it's our duty to do something, because we're still serving. Even though I don't wear the uniform, I still see it my duty to serve. And, you know, I specifically choose inner city youth because that's where I came from. And I understand the struggles that kids in the inner city go through, you know, being in single parent homes, you know, not having a lot financially, maybe not knowing where their next meal is going to come. I could connect and relate to them because I come from that same environment. And so that's why I choose to serve. And I'm probably doing that for the rest of my life, you know, with everything that I have.
Throughout what he calls an unexpected life, Remy said the most important lesson he learned was the value of hard work.
If you do the work, you will be able to achieve whatever you want to achieve. That's one thing that the Navy taught me. You know, I showed up to the Navy unable to swim, skinny and academically disqualified to be a SEAL. I did the hard work. The Navy showed, you know, rewarded me for doing the hard work. I was able to go to SEAL training and become a SEAL. So that's one thing. Hard work pays off. Sometimes it may seem like it won't, but it does.